Good evening, everybody. There we go. It's a blessing to be here with you all. My name is Theon Hill, and on behalf of the Communication Department, allow me to welcome you to Skating Through Glass Ceilings, an impactful conversation exploring sport, gender, and equity. This event is hosted and sponsored by the Communication Department. There we go, Ty, I see you. You better represent. The Communication Department aims to develop ethical, articulate leaders who can inform and inspire audiences worldwide for Christ and His kingdom. Students gain skills to be thoughtful consumers and courageous creators of media content that shapes our culture. Courses encourage students to analyze intersecting issues of race, gender, politics, and power across traditional and digital media. Communication majors master storytelling tools from public speaking and creative writing to video production and social media strategy. Through academic rigor and experiential learning, the Communication Department prepares graduates to advance human dignity, empathy, and justice. Alumni pursue careers in journalism, marketing, public relations, broadcasting, ministry, education, and more. This evening dialogue aligns with the department's commitment to host programs that engage the mind and inspire the spirit. By wrestling with complex questions of identity, bias, and representation in athletics, we move closer to a more just society. We sincerely hope you are enriched by the insights shared and connections forged at this special event. Thank you for joining us on this journey toward greater understanding. And without any further ado, allow me to introduce the captain of our ship in the Communication Department, Dr. Emily Langan.
Good evening. This is such a joy tonight. This really does mark the intersection of my vocation and my avocation. First and foremost, I am a college professor, but right behind that, I am a hockey fan. And tonight is a special night for me to be able to bring months of work to be able to bring our guests on the stage this evening. Let me give you a little bit of their bios as I introduce them. It's my honor to introduce Dr. James Angelini. James is the Associate Professor and Associate Chair of the Communication Department at the University of Delaware. He completed his PhD at Indiana University's prestigious telecommunications program. His pioneering research examines viewers' cognitive and emotional reactions to televised sports. In his acclaimed career, Dr. Angelini has published over 25 articles investigating factors that influence viewers' choices and measure the neurological reactions to sports broadcasts. His expertise as a media scholar provides keen insights into the underlying gender and racial bias that exist. Dr. Angelini is an admired instructor who guides his students to think critically about media. His courses include public speaking, sports broadcasting, and others that are students' favorites. Students describe Dr. Angelini as an inspiring professor who supports their professional growth, and his university service on committees has enhanced their educational experience campus-wide. Please join me in welcoming a dedicated educator, innovator in his field, and leading voice in media, psychological, and communication research, Dr. James Angelini. And our second guest this evening, sorry, I'm about to fangirl out here on you. Kendall Coyne Schofield is nothing short of a living legend in the sport of ice hockey. Notice I said ice hockey, not women's ice hockey. As the captain of the United States women's national team, she has captured an incredible 24 medals in international competition for Team USA, including a gold at the 2018 Winter Games. I've said before to some of you, Kendall has never come home from her three appearances at the Olympics without bringing home a medal. Kendall is one of the most dominant forces in women's hockey for her speed, her skill, and her competitive drive. She further made history in 2019 when she was selected as the first woman ever to compete in the NHL All-Star skills competition. matched up against the fastest male hockey players in the world. Kendall finished the fastest skater competition with an astounding 14.34 seconds. You'll see that later today. And it was less than a second behind the speed demon that is Connor McDavid. In that powerful moment, Kendall earned her nickname, the fastest woman on ice, and has brought long overdue attention to the elite ability of female players. Today, Kendall continues to break barriers as one of the first players signed to the brand new Professional Women's Hockey League, set to begin play in 2024. It's been Kendall's dream to provide a viable professional league for the best women's players on the planet to showcase their elite talents. Beyond her achievements on the ice, Kendall serves as a coach and a broadcast analyst for the Chicago Blackhawks. She is a co-owner of the professional women's soccer team here in town, the Chicago Red Stars, and along with her husband, is the co-founder of a charitable and philanthropic foundation. Her perseverance and excellence has propelled women's sports forward. Her induction this year into the Northeastern University Athletic Hall of Fame is most deserved. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with me a woman who has skated through glass ceilings her entire career, an inspiration to all women and girls who dare to dream big, Kendall Coyne Schofield. It seems a likely first question, Kendall, to ask you, why hockey?
Well, first off, thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be here. For those of you that don't know, I grew up right down the street, about 40 minutes, but that's down the street in Chicago and Illinois, right? So, but thank you so much for having me. How did I get into hockey? Well, I have an older brother, and my parents signed him up for all different sports, hockey being one of those. And when I was three, they brought me to the rink to watch him play. And if you know me, I'm kind of energetic and don't sit well. And I'm like, well, I'm not just going to sit here and watch him play. And well over 25 years ago, the girls that were in the rink were watching their brothers play like I was, or they were figure skating. So my parents, when I said I want to play, they got me figure skates because that's what the girls were doing. And after a week in the figure skates, and I must say I absolutely love figure skating. All of the Olympic games I go to, you will see me front row and center cheering as loudly as I'm allowed to at figure skating. But it wasn't what my brother was doing. He was playing hockey, and I wanted hockey skates. And so after a week in the figure skates, I complained as much as I could to convince my parents to get me hockey skates, and I achieved at three and haven't looked back since. And that's how my journey in the sport started.
And you've had a series of really essential mentors. If you haven't read Small Plug, you'll hear me mention it a couple of times. We have some copies in the lobby in Kendall's book, As Fast As Her. You talk so much about the mentors that you've had, including, I think, let's see if my slides work. This is Kendall at age six. You want to tell us what that is?
Yeah, so those are my siblings, my older brother on the far left, my little brother kind of in the middle, and then I'm holding my sister. And thankfully, you kind of can't tell because I'm so embarrassed now, but I'm sticking out my tongue like a 7 or 6 year old does. But that picture is with Cami Granato. She grew up right around here in Downers Grove. And shortly after the 98 Winter Olympics, the first time women's hockey was in the Olympic Games, Cami held a hockey camp at the Seven Bridges Ice Arena, which I see some local hockey players in the front row. I know you've probably all been there, played there, been on the ice there, like me as well. My parents signed me up for her hockey camp. And up until that point, I was just started playing, and I really didn't see any other girls playing hockey. When I would go to school, you know, PE hockey would roll around, I'd be so excited, and none of the other girls wanted to play. Or it was just, you know, you really didn't see girls in the sport. And oftentimes there would be boys saying, well, girls don't play hockey. And I would only see my brother and his friends and never really any other girls. So I was like, maybe they're right. And I kind of started to doubt myself. I was young. But then my parents signed me up for Cami's camp. And I walked into the camp, and there were over 100 girls there. And I was like, all these naysayers, all these people who say girls don't play hockey, I'm like, they need to come here. Like, sign up for the camp. This is amazing. And so that was kind of a moment that really changed my life. I know I talked about it in the book, but I remember Cammie's red, white, and blue Nike hockey gloves. I still have the image of those, like, in my mind to this day. I remember her hockey skates. I remember her track suit. I remember her hockey bag, all of the Team USA stuff. And then at the end of camp, she pulled out her gold medal. And that's when I turned to my parents. I said, I want to go to the Olympics. At that point, I didn't know, like, really what the Olympics were. I didn't know women really played hockey for Team USA. I saw the Blackhawks. And for those of you that grew up in my generation, the games weren't actually on TV. So if you wanted to see a hockey game, you had to go to a hockey game around here, and you definitely didn't see a women's game. And so going back to that camp, that was a big, big moment for me. And when I realized, like, women do play hockey. Okay, I don't want to play on the Blackhawks. I want to play on Team USA. How do I get there? You know, my parents kind of laughed, like, oh, yes, you can do it, honey. You got this. And so sure enough, you know, that moment really did kind of change the trajectory of my life in a way that I didn't know at such a young age. But from that moment on, I'm like, I want to play for Team USA.
A really inspiring full circle moment when she calls you after you've had your gold medal. You want to tell them that part? I'm skipping ahead to the Olympic story. We'll cycle back, but
yeah, and one of my other mentors that she wrote the foreword of my book, Billie Jean King, and I think is a mentor for hopefully everyone and anyone in this room, just such a champion of life. But, you know, Billie always says you need to see it to be it, and that was my see it, be it moment, was seeing Cammie, seeing her gold medal, holding her gold medal, and being like, this is what I want to do. And so fast forward to 2018 when we won gold. It was 20 years since the U.S. won gold. The last gold medal was the one that Cammie and the 1998 team won. I got back to the village, and mind you, the 2018 Olympics were in South Korea, so a pretty significant time change back home to here in Chicago and to the United States for all of my teammates. But after we won, it's crazy. There's drug testing, and it's a process to get out of the rink and to get back into the village to change and to, you know, just enjoy the moment. And we finally got back to the village. My roommate was Hillary Knight, one of my longtime teammates, who also was very influenced by Cammie. She actually wears number 21, which was Cammie's number, which I don't know if anyone else can wear 21 after Cammie and Hillary wear it. But we were in the village, and I sat down on my bed, and I had a bunch of text messages. But the one that popped up, and it stunned me in a way that just brought tears to my face, was from Cammie, just saying congratulations, and she's so proud of me, and she knew that we could do it. And a part that's not in the book was, we had a Zoom session with a guest speaker when we were at the Olympics the day before our gold medal game, and we didn't know who it was, and it was Cammie. And after we hung up, I turned to Hillary, I go, we're winning. After we heard from Cam, like, we're winning, I can feel it. And so that was a pretty cool full circle moment to have that, and have that message from Cammie that I've since saved.
How do you think those various role models have informed your career, as now you're in that position and you're showing your gold medal to six-year-olds? We just did it backstage. And how has it shaped your, what does it mean to be a mentor for you?
Oh, it means everything. I think everyone in this room is a mentor, a leader, a role model in one way or another, whether you know it or you don't. There's someone who's looking to you, looking up to you, trying to learn from you. And I think I look back and I realized how much of an influence Cammie had on me, how much of an influence Billie Jean has had on me, how much I've learned from them. And if I can provide that sort of influence and inspiration to encourage someone to chase something that's going to change their life forever, that they're going to wake up every day and be excited to do, it's truly an honor, because I couldn't imagine my life without this game. And there was a point in time where I almost quit this game, because I didn't look around the room. I didn't see anyone who looked like me. I didn't, you know, there was no one really lifting me up or supporting me, and other than, you know, my family, of course. But so I think it's super important, whether, you know, it's you know you're a role model, you know someone's looking up to you or asking you questions, or it's just the way that you handle yourself and carry yourself, and the way that you know you go about your day. I think it is an incredible honor to be that, you know, to somebody else if I can be.
Dr. Angelini, if I can bring you in and ask you, how do you think the media has shaped women as role models?
That's a really good question. But before I answer that, it wasn't just a six-year-old that was looking at the medals. As an Olympic scholar, I saw my first medal at 50, and it was fabulous. So I just want to throw that out there. So how does the media shape female mentors? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah.
I mean, up until this point, most of them are individuals who have broken a barrier, have achieved some sort of level of greatness, and it's just how the media frames them. It portrays them as being the ultimate, the forefront of their field, of their, especially in talking about sports, of sport. I mean, you mentioned Billie Jean King. I mean, I remember as a little kid myself, you know, with the Bobby Riggs match, and Billie Jean has been a mentor and an icon. And it's really just how they're, you know, it's the fact that they push their achievement. But it's really, I think it's a little bit more difficult for women to be portrayed that way, because especially in the world of sport, I mean, the role of women has not always been a valued role. Not at all. I mean, you could probably, for every iconic woman in sport that could be that mentor, you could, most people could probably name two or three men, if not more. That's just because of how the media portrays them. It's not because there aren't important women out there in sport. It's just that it's not been as valued. But I think the tides are changing. We have people like Hillary. We have people like Billie Jean. We have people from, you know, basketball and all these different sports that now we have these young girls can look up to, which is really, really important. And I think it just perpetuates the ability for these young girls to say, I can do that. Same as you saw that when you had Cammy, and she's like, it's, you know, it showed you who you could be or what you could be. And I think having, you know, the next generation of mentors like that is only going to inspire more young girls and young women to aspire to things that maybe our society didn't think about 20, 30 years ago.
The good news is that women are getting less invisible in the world of sport. For those of you who are unfamiliar with MECA, otherwise known as the Hockey Hall of Fame in Toronto, it has not broadly represented the women's game. But if we go there, there is something of Kendall Coyne Schofield's there. Will you tell them that story? That's probably my favorite story from the book, of how a piece of her game is in the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Yes, no problem. But just talking about the evolution of the game, in 2007, the IIHF, the International Ice Hockey Federation, announced that they are going to be launching the Under-18 Women's World Championship. Mind you, there were many, many U18 men's world championships to take place prior to 2007. But finally, the IIHF said, hey, we're going to have a U18 Women's World Championship. And I happened to be the lucky birth year that was the first eligible birth year for the U18 Women's World Championship. So that was 2007-2008 season. I was 15, and the age is 15, 16, and 17-year-old. So I was the youngest. I didn't know if I'd make the team. Thankfully, I got lucky. I worked hard. I made the team. Fast forward to the gold medal game. We beat Canada 5-2 in the final, and I happened to score the third goal, which is also happens to be the game-winning goal. And again, I was 15. I was sophomore in high school. I have braces. I was just enamored by everything. I put on my first Team USA jersey. I was just, everything was so exciting and new, and I was so happy to be there. And after the game, our equipment manager, which was the first time I ever experienced an equipment manager, I'm like, wait, so I don't have to go to a pro shop to get my skate sharpened? Like, this is awesome. So everything was just so new. The equipment manager asked me to come into the hallway, and I was like, okay, sure, no problem. And he said, this is Phil. He's from the Hockey Hall of Fame, and he would like to take your stick. And I kind of panicked. I'm like, wait, No. Like, hockey sticks are really expensive. My mom's going to kill me if I leave here without a hockey stick. Like, I cannot give you my stick. And then I was like, I got to ask my parents. Like, I can't just give you my stick. Like, these are really expensive. And the equipment manager is looking at me like I have 8 heads, which I understand now why. And I'm like, but wait, I got to ask my parents. And then I realized this is, again, for the younger crowd in the room, like, you know, cell phones weren't like they are today. I didn't have international data on my phone, so I didn't really, if I didn't have Wi-Fi, I couldn't use my phone, and it was like a flip phone or something, like Nokia, you know, if anyone knows what those are. So I was like, I gotta call my parents, and I'm like, oh crap, my phone doesn't work here. And so then I'm like, maybe my parents are still here. Let me go try and run and find them. And my equipment manager told me, no, they sent the parents back to this room for a reception. Like, you're not going to be able to get to your parents. And I was like, oh no, I have to make this adult decision by myself. This is going to be, so I gave him my hockey stick. And so we go to the reception and my parents are there and I kind of like walking like on eggshells. And my mom's like, is everything okay? And I'm like, Mom, I swear, I'm so sorry. I gave this guy my hockey stick. I'm never going to get it back. I need a new hockey stick. And I'm really sorry. And she's like, who did you give your hockey stick to? And I said, well, his name's Phil. He's from the Hockey Hall of Fame. And she's like, Kendall, it's fine. And I'm like, no, Mom, I know you worked so hard so I could have this hockey stick. And, you know, back in the day, there were 2-piece hockey sticks. Okay, I know some of you guys are like, wait, what? And she found this blade that I really wanted, and it was hard to find. It was a wood blade. And anyways, I'm like, I know you worked so hard to get me that stick before the tournament, and I just gave it to somebody. And so long story short, that stick is in the Hockey Hall of Fame. And a couple of years ago during COVID, the Hockey Hall of Fame reached out and asked for my skates from the fastest skater lap. So those are in the Hall of Fame too.
Did you have to ask your mom and dad on that one?
No, I made the executive. I was now the executive director of my decisions. And so I made it. But I was kind of like, ooh, do I give them to them? I don't know. But no, I did send them to Toronto, and those are there as well.
I wonder how often Phil Pritchard at the Hockey Hall of Fame hears, I've got to ask my mom and dad before I can give you this artifact.
Well, welcome to negotiating.
At least you know where it is. It's safekeeping.
Yeah. And you're negotiating with a 15-year-old. That's what you get.
It's terrific. I love it. You go through, as she said, she was an elite athlete internationally, skating for Team USA by 15 on the U18 team, right? And when you decide to go to college, you knew what you wanted to major in. For my students in the room, Kendall, what did you major in college?
Comm. Yes. I was a communication major from day one. That was actually the major that I wanted to go into, and that was when I was going through the recruiting process. I was very fortunate to have a lot of options as a student athlete, and the options narrowed pretty quickly when I wanted to go to the best communication school that there was. Syracuse was right up there, but women's hockey program wasn't where I wanted it to be. But Syracuse was great. Boston University was great. Now they're a rival. I even hate saying that. Ugh. But that's okay. So I was looking at the communication schools throughout the recruiting process and what they had to offer. I remember actually, and again, I'm bringing them up again, which is fine. It's a great school. On my BU visit, I stayed with Jenny Taft, who obviously is an incredible analyst. And, you know, I watched her through what she did in the comm school for the 48 hours I was on campus when student athletes took official visits. I think those are a thing of the past since I've heard. But Northeastern's comm school and the co-op program that it had to offer really excited me. And I think the reason that I wanted to go into communication is because it in a way it's broad, but in another way it's specific, and you get to make what you want of the major. And for me, I wanted to stay in sport. And really the main place that I saw women in sport and the majors that they had at that time, this is well over 10 years ago, was through broadcasting. And that was my initial reason for wanting to be a communication major, was this is my avenue to stay in sport. I couldn't imagine my life without sport. And a lot of the women are doing broadcasting. Well, I've been very fortunate to do broadcasting. When I went to Northeastern, I tried a little bit of sideline reporting. It was a little rough. I look back at some of those films, but I learned a lot. But it was just to get that hands-on experience and to see behind the scenes. And I did a co-op with the Chicago Blackhawks in the media relations department, which was a whole different side, off camera, you know, completely different. And I remember from that experience saying to my parents, like, wow, it's a lot easier to play hockey than it is to work in hockey. Like, these hours are tough. There's no pregame meal. There's no pregame nap. But it is go, 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 go. Long hours, long days, long nights, early mornings. Like, you are there. But if you love what you do, you do it. And so I was able to kind of see that side of pro sports, being a media relations intern. And so I think when I look back to my experience, just having the different options, different experiences, broadcasting, media relations. Obviously, I'm into coaching now, and I think my major helped prepare me for any hat, because I've worn a lot of different hats, and I still do, but I feel like the communication major prepares you for any hat that you will put on in any way, shape, or form.
And for those who wonder about Kendall or any other elite athlete as a student, I want to read you just a small section from her book. This is after you started at Northeastern, and you wrote, at the same time I was reveling in the buzz around women's hockey, I had school to contend with. I sat down with my athletic academic advisor, who was taken aback by my certainty of my academic ambition. I had a 5-year scholarship, and I wanted to get both my bachelor's and my master's in that time. I also wanted a plan fully laid out in advance, so I knew what we were going to accomplish. That plan would mean taking extra classes most semesters. She took a total of 20 hours each semester, which is a heavy load. Most student athletes start off taking the easiest classes possible when they enter college, so they get acclimated to the demands of juggling academics and sports. When my advisor tried to suggest that I take those classes as a good fit for me, I told her I had no interest in the commonly traveled path. That was ambitious. And you finished, not only finished, magna cum laude, huh? Yeah. In 5 years.
Yeah. Yeah. I think.
And in that time, you took your third college season off?
Yes.
Yeah, because you knew going in that right in the middle of your college career, something was happening.
Yes, and I will say, you could do that too. While it was hard, demanding, you know, there were long nights, early mornings, I'm someone that the more that I have on my plate, in some way, I find that the better I do. And, you know, it's just, for me, it was a go, go, go of 5 years, but I loved every second of it. I wish I could go back and just absorb the information and learn, and I loved my classes, and I'm sure, like, your comm classes, there's a lot of collaboration. It's not, you know, quiet. Like, there's a lot of, you know, smaller classes, and they're dynamic, and you learn from others' opinions, and I miss it so much. I'm actually going back to Northeastern on Thursday, and I haven't been back much since, and I'm so excited. I hope I get to see some of my professors, because they truly did make an impact on me, and I loved it so much. But after my sophomore year, I made I'm going to back up just a little bit. 2010, I got invited to try out for the Olympic team. And the tryouts are in 2009, so they're the summer before the Winter Olympics. They bring 41 players to try out, and I was one of those 41. I was the youngest player. I was going into my senior year in high school. Carl Sandburg Eagles. Go Eagles. So I was going into my senior year that summer. I went to the tryout. At the end of the tryout, the coach stood up here like I am, and it was head coach was Mark Johnson at the time, and he read off from A to Z the roster of the players who made the first cut. So there were about, I think, 25 players or so that made the first cut, and in 2010, only 21 players made the Olympic team. And so he got Megan Duggan, who was the captain, and I didn't hear Coyne, so I knew I had gotten cut. And so I was like, shoot, that was my dream. It got cut. I was young, but had plenty of time to make it back again.
And you go back to high school at this point.
I do go back to high school, but I was like, wow, I'm going to be so cool. In high school, I went to the Olympics. Like, I thought it was going to be cool. And then I went back. I was like, no, I got cut, everyone. I'm back. Nice to see you again. But I walk out of the room, and they handed me a plane ticket. And that plane ticket said Calgary. And I was looking. I'm like, no, Chicago, wrong, like, Calgary, Chicago. I don't know. Maybe this is the wrong ticket. Oh, no, you have a game tonight against Canada in Calgary. And I'm like looking at the general manager, like, what do you mean? I just got cut. Well, since I was still under 18 eligible, I was going to play in the U18 three-game series that was still going on. And I'm like, wow, okay. It was devastating, but at the same time, I'm like, I'm so lucky. I just had this USA jersey ripped right off my back, and now I have the opportunity to go put it right back on. When a lot of these players are walking out of the room, and some of them may never play hockey again. And my career was really just beginning. And so as hard as it was that moment where I had to look at myself in the mirror and say, you know what, you weren't good enough, you weren't fast enough, you weren't strong enough, you didn't think the game fast enough. However, you have an opportunity to change that from now until the next Olympic Games. And so I got cut in 2010, so now fast forward to 2014 of, you know, 4 years watching the 2010 games, wishing I was there, you know, working. How am I gonna have a different result? For those of you that, you know, may have seen me walk in, I'm not the biggest player. I'm oftentimes actually quite the opposite. I'm the smallest player on the team. But I realized, well, even though I'm the smallest, why can't I be the strongest? It's not an excuse. My height, I can't control it, but I can control my strength. And I think that's something that resonates with me every day is like, what can you control? I can control my strength. I can control my attitude. I can control my effort. So how am I going to respond to this adversity? I'm either going to use it to make me better, or it's going to define me and make me worse. So fast forward to 2014, the summer 2013 was the tryouts, 41 players, same process. This time I made the first cut. And because I made the first cut, I had to take the year off of school. So I had to say to Northeastern, I'm not coming to school this year. Even if I made the team or didn't make the team, I was not playing in the NCAA that year. So after my sophomore year, which I think 2 years of college hockey really did help prepare me for the international game for that year, I made the Olympic team and, oh, you're ready to go. And that was 2014 games. Those were, so my first Olympic games in Sochi, Russia. And I will say, we didn't win silver, we lost the gold, and that's our sport. You know, there's a lot of sports, there's different mindsets. You'll meet different athletes at the games where they want to just come home with a medal, or they want to place in the top six. For us, it's gold or bust. That's our sport, that's where we're at, that's the expectation we have on ourselves as a program. So coming home with a silver was challenging at times, but I think you learn more about yourself, more about the team through adversity than you do success. So it was an opportunity for us to learn from it, as hard as it was.
Dr. Angelini, you have studied the Olympics since 2000, the 2000 games roughly. How do you think the telecasts have changed? How has the media changed their coverage of those Olympics?
Olympics in general, or, I mean, there is, I mean, first off, there's so many more events. I mean, in 2000, there's a lot of also different platforms. There are sports that used to not get any coverage that do today. And for that reason, that's why we also see a lot more coverage of female athletes competing than ever before. If you look at the numbers back around 2000, 2002, 2004, compared to today, I mean, today we see a lot more female athletes being talked about. We see a lot more female athletes on screen. Part of the contribution to that is the fact that, I mean, at least here in the United States, the female athletes are winning a lot more than the male athletes are too. So they're succeeding. And the media is starting to really to recognize that. They're starting to feature women more in the prime time areas where they have the largest audiences. It's not just being streamed on the USA Network always, or, you know, the Golf Channel or whatever NBC owns, because the NBC has had the rights to the Olympics in the United States since the 2000 games. They are actually getting NBC time. Maybe not every sport, but they're getting NBC daytime, NBC nighttime. So, I mean, the landscape has changed in that there's just so many more platforms, so many more opportunities for sports to be shown, and we're seeing many more, particularly female athletes, in those prime time slots being pushed as the face of the games.
And can I jump on that too quickly?
Certainly.
So the U18 Women's World Championships that I had mentioned, and my mom always tells a story that she was just hitting refresh on the internet bar to wonder, because my parents weren't able to go to the tournament and the game was in the middle of the night, and so she just kept hitting refresh, and the game went into overtime. And so she's obviously, like, you guys can imagine, and imagine, like, slow internet too, not like today's internet. So just pressing this button, and that's how I think back to that, and I'm like, it almost breaks my heart, because it was such a proud moment of my career, and my parents weren't there to see it, and my mom's sitting there hitting a refresh button because these games, you know, the U18 Men's World Championships would never not be on TV, right? I think we can all agree to that. And so here she is pushing a button, and I ended up scoring the goal in overtime, and she's like, I was screaming, I probably woke up the neighbors, but I'm like, that's how she found out, is pressing the refresh button. And now, even my first few senior world championships weren't on TV. They were on TV in Canada on TSN. The coverage there, they do a wonderful job, and they're always, I'm sure you could speak to it factually, I'm just as a fan. It's, you know, it's always on TV there quite often, but here in the United States it hasn't been. And so for those of you that have tuned in, the NHL Network has picked up the Women's World Championships each year for the last probably 5-6 years, but I mean, we're talking 5-6 years, that's not very long. And I think one thing too, in terms of like the women's athletes, I always like to talk about the women's soccer team. I think we try and learn a lot from them. I think women's soccer is 20 iterations ahead of women's hockey, where they are from an international game to a professional game, and to the platform in which their athletes carry. How many of you can name 5 players on the men's national team? Anyone?
Soccer, hockey.
A men's soccer team. Men's soccer. How many of you can name 5 on the women's team?
Yay.
A little bit more. A little bit. I think you guys can probably, a lot of here, who can pop some off right away. You got the Alex Morgans, right? I could sit up here and do them all. But, you know, that's you think about, like, women's soccer, and, you know, you ask a group of people, and they can ramble off, you know, the women's soccer players really quickly. And then you ask them about the men's soccer players, and there's usually 1 or 2, and then it kind of, I'm not sure who else. And it's not a shot at the men's team. It's more so the coverage that the women's soccer players have earned and received has risen their platform to a prominence in which everyone knows them. And that's where we want to get to. It doesn't, you know, men's soccer, women's soccer, it doesn't matter. These are the best soccer players in the world. And so that's where women's hockey, we have a ways to go to get there. We're working hard. It's conversations like this that help. And, you know, I know we'll talk about it, but, you know, what's to come as well from a professional landscape too.
And let's talk about 2018. First, Dr. Angelini, 2018 marks a transition moment in the NBC coverage of the Olympics. Do you want to speak to that for a minute? And then I'll ask Kendall her experience of 2018.
I mean, 2018 is where we really started seeing the trend where NBC was finally, like, not just equity. I mean, we aren't just seeing equal coverage, but the events that feature the female athletes are getting more coverage. They're being seen more. The athletes are being mentioned by name more than their male counterparts. And so, I mean, I think that's starting to show a bit more of the value, at least NBC sees in them, also because when you look at things like more medals won. Also, you know, in the mid-2010s until today, a lot more women in the audience watching, you know, the Olympics than men. So, you know, they're showing and bringing the audiences, I think, what they want. And it's giving them the opportunity to really feature these premier athletes, not these premier female athletes, these premier athletes.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but 2018 is the first year that the airtime scales tipped towards female athletes.
And it's remained that way from 2018. We call them the 2020, though they did it, you know, it was 2021 games, and then again the 2022 games.
So one of those athletes at the 2018 games is this moment. So Kendall, talk to us. How does that moment feel?
Definitely the
it's
best.
Different than the silver.
Yeah, that was by far the best moment of my hockey career to date. That was just an incredible moment. How many, did anyone see it? Or maybe see it on YouTube afterwards, a few of you, the shootout, Jocelyn Lamoureux-Davidson's oops, I did it again goal. My eyes were closed. I was so nervous. my eyes were closed. And then with Maddie, I was like this when Canada went to the last shooter. But that was it was a surreal moment, a moment obviously, again, you look at 2014 and then, you know, the success in 2018 and you kind of have that like, oh, it was worth it. It was a grind of a year. So before the Olympics, we go into residency, it's called. And before that Olympics, we were resided in Wesley Chapel, Florida, which I know what you're thinking, like, oh, interesting. I mean, the Florida Panthers were in the Stanley Cup final last year. Like, there's hockey there. It's, you know, but so we were resided for a year. And, I mean, it's every day it's a grind. And so going into those Olympics, while we were all exhausted and, you know, we grinded it out for six months leading up to the Olympics just to for everything to come to fruition and to get that feeling of the gold medal around your neck. And I have my medals, and anyone that wants to see them afterwards, they're out there. But if you look and you're like, oh my gosh, it's so heavy, like everyone's response, like you can see like in their lips afterwards on TV, and it is really heavy. And it was just such a cool moment, and to have my family there, my husband was there, and
he should be there. Nope, there's you. quintessential bite the metal moment.
I got the first bite.
Okay. And then there.
Yeah.
The moment featured amongst other things on Sports Illustrated and others. He's your fiancé at this point.
Oh, yeah, sorry. He was my
right?
Yes, he was my fiancé. Sorry, yes. He was my fiancé. We got married that summer. But it was really cool. Like, no one was supposed to be allowed on the ice, and he's a pretty big guy. So there wasn't really anything stopping him. But I'm like, the law? They said, don't go on the ice. He's like, I'm going. And he just barreled himself right on the ice, and everyone followed behind him, which was really, really cool. And I think what was so cool after we talking about the media coverage was, you know, we had to have some hard conversations with USA Hockey about a post-Olympic tour. And I know it's an awkward conversation to have because the conversation, if you win, there's this path. If you lose, there's this path. And we have the conversation with them, well, we should be celebrated regardless. I mean, you know, I just said to you, you know, for us, like, it's gold, but this is a platform that women's hockey has every 4 years that we really need to seize and take advantage of. But the conversation is like, nope, if you win, you guys go to New York and LA. If you lose, you go back to Wesley Chapel, pack your bags, and go home. So that was another source of motivation for us too, because we knew, you know, everyone's talking about women's hockey after the Olympics, and if we win, they're really talking about it, and we're going on these talk shows. We went to Ellen in LA, and then everywhere in between, and then we ended up in New York, and we were on talk shows in New York, and just that exposure is so critical to the success of the game, to the investment behind the game. So every time we get on TV or get by, you know, with anybody, it grows the game from the grassroots level on up. So, you know, we kind of had that pressure on our shoulders as well, knowing like, oh, they're going to send our bags packing if we don't win, or we go on this incredible media tour if we do win. And we did.
I'm assuming this is one of the mountaintop experiences. You talk in your book, I thought it was so powerful, as you say, there is no Stanley Cup for women's hockey. And so when you're done with your collegiate career, you hang up your skates, if not for this moment. But this was hard-earned. This comes after the 2017 boycott, right?
Yes.
So let's talk about that for a minute, boycotting the World Championship.
That was difficult. So 2017, the World Championships are in April. 9 months prior to the World Championships, we engaged in a negotiation with USA Hockey, saying we need to receive more equitable support. Up until that point, we didn't make any money. We received a training stipend from the USOPC, and that was it. And we were expected to, after college, you know, work a full-time job to keep yourself afloat, but then train full-time, skate full-time, and win a gold medal full-time. You can't do it half-time and win a gold medal and play at the highest level. And so, you know, we came to USA Hockey 9 months prior to the World Championships. You know, this is what we're looking for. We want to be treated better. Things like the men received $50 a per diem per day, we received $15. And a simple question as to why couldn't be answered. And so it's not like we are coming with like these crazy asks. We are coming with reasonable, equitable asks that were so long overdue. It was insane that we were having these conversations in 2016. And so 9 months go by and the conversations didn't persist. And, you know, I'll be very frank with you. We, you know, there was one conversation, you know, there was someone on the other side of the table who fell asleep. That's how serious our conversations were, our thoughts and our wishes were being taken, not serious at all. So no progress is made. And leading up to the games, our lawyers from Ballard Spahr, who any, again, comm majors, it doesn't matter, any major in this room, like look up Ballard Spahr, like the amount of pro bono work that they've done for women in sport is just incredible. Women's soccer is not women's soccer without Ballard Spahr. Specifically, John Langle was the attorney who represented the 99ers. And so when we started this battle, and we, you know, what do? You guys, I'm sure you guys have done the same thing. You look to who's done it. How do we do this? What do we do? Where do we start with? So we called Julie Foudy. We called the 99ers. How do you do this? What do you do? Talk to John Langle. Well, John Langle's retired, but not because, you know, he answered our phone call and he hasn't stopped working since for us. But so Ballard Spahr said, you guys, they're not taking you very seriously. You know, you're going to have to consider sitting out. And we're like, all right. Like, let's do it. And it wasn't as easy as let's do it. Obviously, there were people making their first team, you know, and then you're on the year before an Olympic year, and this might be your only opportunity to showcase, you know, your talent to USA Hockey to make an Olympic team. So now you're, am I foregoing my Olympic dream, my world championship dream, my first time putting on the U.S. jersey? There's a lot of layers to, you know, you guys might have to boycott. And sure enough, we got to the point, and we had a boycott because there wasn't any progress that was made. And I will say, and they will tell you too, they were blindsided. But that was the only way that we could get any sort of communication. And instead of trying to come to an agreement, trying to be reasonable, have conversations, they instead tried to reach out to replacement players. So players who were American-born players, whether they were in Division I college, Division III college, high school players, players who they were trying to get anybody who would play. But we were one step ahead of them, and we had called all of these players and said, hey, this fight, it's not about the 23 players named to this world championship roster who are not playing. This fight is for the next generation of players and then the game in its whole. And we explained the process throughout of why we were doing this, the treatment that we were receiving. And those players listened, and they all said no. When USA Hockey called them, this could have been their first best and only chance to ever play for Team USA as a replacement player for the World Championship. And they said no. They said no. This fight is bigger than just those 23 players. And so that forced them to continue to have conversation with us. And 2 days before the World Championship, and our first game was against Canada, to make it even more special. Oh, and the World Championship was on home soil, which isn't often. It was in Plymouth, Michigan, at the USA Hockey Arena, to make it even more poetic. But we were able to come to an agreement. We were flying to Philadelphia for meetings, flying to Denver for meetings, on the phone. I remember I was charging my phone multiple times a day because that's the amount that we were communicating with everyone. Just with every turn, every step, we would have a conversation with them. And we're like, all right, we made progress. We'd wake up the next day and get phone calls that, oh, USA Hockey called me, they want to play. And we're like, wait, really? We thought we made progress today, and you know, we weren't. So we were able to come to an agreement. We played. We won. And we are now three contracts in, and our next contract will be up in 2024-2025 season, and we'll start that negotiation process again. But, you know, one thing out of – there's a lot of things out of that. You know, for example, in training, we never got post-training meals. So you'd be at the rink for 5-6 hours a day, and there would never be a meal. You know, and I know this, like, and I see some of you are like, wait, what? Yeah, it's like a wait, what moment. It's like, but those are the conversations we were having. Like, we're asking for a meal after training for 5 hours. We're not asking for, like, anything that was unreasonable or irrational for what we deserve as elite professional athletes. So now things have changed drastically. And the one thing out of it that I was going to mention was the rivalry series. We talked about how there has to be more programming. We can't just play 10 games a year. You guys have to create more programming. And part of their rejection to that was, well, it's not our responsibility. The other countries, they can step up and do things too. We said, no, you're a leader in this sport, USA Hockey. USA Hockey and Hockey Canada, you're a leader in this sport. Create programming, put money behind programming, put resources behind programming, and out of that was created the rivalry series. If you guys aren't doing anything on Wednesday night, U.S. is playing Canada in game one of this year's rivalry series. I'm not there. I had a baby in July, so I will return in February for the rivalry series, but we've created more programming out of our negotiation dating back to 2016, which has been incredible to see.
Can I ask you, how did you get involved? Because you were in there as a negotiator. You were not one of the people receiving the phone call. You were the ones making the phone calls. How did that fall to you? The name of the boycott is Be Bold for Change.
Yeah.
Is the hashtag they used.
Yeah, and I love to give credit to Monique and Jocelyn Lamoureux, the twins on our team who have since retired, but they were the ones that made that first phone call. That phone call that took a lot of courage, a lot of guts to call John Langle and say, we need to implement change. We don't know how to do it, but can you help us? And so they made that first phone call. And I was in college and I had just graduated that year when we were boycotting. So I was kind of like I would say I was like the younger player, but because I was in the program for so long at that point, given that I played, you know, at 15 years old and I was just around, even though I was still young by a number, I had a lot of experience with the team, and it was, you know, something I knew I could be a voice, and an advocate at the table, and it was like, yeah, I'm here to help. You know, and some players are like, I'm here to receive. Some players are, I'm here to sit and negotiate. It's kind of, I would say, a personality thing. And just being around the program for so long, I was like, you know, I'm ready to fight this fight. Let's go.
Dr. Angelini, this is what a pro athlete and her colleagues could do. Are there other ways that the average fan would, or the average sport consumer could address some of the inequities that are still persistent? What is the option of the consumer?
I mean, first and foremost, I mean, social media. I mean, if you want to have your voices heard, I mean, every single one of you, I think, nowadays has something in your pocket, in your bag, connected to some social media platform, be it Instagram, TikTok, what used to be Twitter, I'm not gonna call it what it is, Snapchat, whatever it is, your voices can now be heard more than ever before. But also you can make some choices. If you see that athletes, you know that athletes aren't, you know, being respected for who they are, for what they do, I mean, that's what you gotta do, is just make your voices heard. That's how movements happen. That's how things happen. And, you know, people who are Gen Z have that mobility now more than ever before, that motivation more than ever before to utilize the technology for their causes, for their beliefs. I think that's true more so than for any generation that came before. I mean, we all had our ways to make that happen, but, you know, that little screen in your pocket that connects you to social media gets your voice heard. And then more people will see it that also believe in the same things you do. And it gets the message out there.
If we're in a little bit of a roller coaster ride, we're down for boycott, we're up for the Olympics, but this will not be the only mountaintop experience we have coming up. Let's talk about those 14 seconds. I know I was hoarse screaming watching you skate in San Jose. Tell us how skating in the NHL All-Star skills competition comes about.
Yeah, well, you talk about social media, but I also think there's allies too. There's supporters. There's people who lift you up, and that's how this moment happened. Patrick Burke, who we'll get into professional hockey, but he works in player safety with the NHL, and he was put on the All-Star skills competition committee when he joined the player safety department, and he was allowed to bring one thing to the table as a new member of the skills committee. And he stood up and he said, I want to incorporate women. And he was told to sit back down. And that was year one. And so fast forward now to 2019, Nathan MacKinnon gets hurt. He takes a puck off the foot. He was scheduled to skate. He couldn't skate. I get to San Jose. We had a call before we got there, and I was scheduled to rehearse the accuracy shooting competition, which, you know, the one with the targets and you knock them off, there's five targets. So myself and Renata Fast from Team Canada, we were going to do it at the same time.
But as a demonstration,
yes,
not in the competition.
Yes, just a demonstration. So you wouldn't have even seen it on TV. Just the people at the SAP Center in San Jose would have seen us. We were in our USA Hockey jersey, Team Canada jersey. Brianna Decker, my teammate, was doing the premier passer, I think it was called. The name's changed, so I apologize if I'm a little off. I think hers was premier passer. And then Rebecca Johnston did the one with the Gatorade bottle one.
Yeah.
Yeah, I forget the names. You guys know what I'm talking about. And so we got to San Jose, and they asked us, hey, will you guys help us rehearse for the event? And of course, like, a nice rink to any hockey player is like a kid in a candy store. We're like, yeah, extra ice? Sure, no problem. Like, we'd love to help. So we get to the rink. I land. I was one of the last ones to arrive. We get to the rink, and Patrick, he's like, Kendall, I want you to do the fastest skater. And they really didn't want us to rehearse that one because you are exerting, obviously, some energy. You can pull a muscle, especially after a five-hour flight from Chicago to San Jose with a stop in, I forget where, in California, but I stopped somewhere. But he's like, I really want you to do it. I just want to see what you get. I'm like, yeah, sure, no problem. So I go from the airport right to the rink. I'm running, and he's like, you gotta hurry, like, because they were already starting and they were practicing the run of show. So I was the last skater in the run of show. I got on the ice. I was like, okay, I'm good. I stretched a little bit, whatever, I'm fine. So I skated it, got whatever I got. Well, little did I know about the Nathan MacKinnon situation that's going on. Patrick now has a time. He leaves that night, the rehearsal. He takes my time to Gary Bettman. And he says, Nathan can't skate, Kendall can. And Gary says to Patrick.
Gary is the NHL commissioner.
Oh, yes, sorry. Gary Bettman. Yeah, the NHL commissioner. And Gary says to Patrick, well, you think she can do it? And he says, heck yes, she can do it. And he said, okay, get the proper approvals. And the approvals were the NHLPA, the seven players that were scheduled to skate, and then the league. So the NHLPA was a big one because I was a competitor. The person who wins receives $25,000. And I'm not a union member of the NHLPA. So they had to get approval if I was to win, which I'm always about, like, winning. But I knew it was going to be tough to win. But they had to get those approval. All the players said yes. The PA said yes. The league said yes. It was a go. I don't know any of this is going on, obviously. Like, we are doing events, whatever. I go to bed, I wake up. And if some of you may have read this in my book, but I had a missed phone call. And it was a random number, so I didn't answer. And they didn't leave a voicemail. I honestly thought it was a drug tester. Because we get drug tested all the time, and like random numbers. And I'm like, oh, like, they're probably at my front door in Chicago. I was just like, I'm so overwhelmed. And then they call again. And then he texted me. He's like, Kendall, it's Patrick. Call me. And I'm like, oh, hey, Patrick. And then he's like, Kendall, you're gonna be the first woman to compete in the NHL All-Star Skills Competition. Do you need anything? Are you good? Do you need water? You need food? I'm like, what? Yes, I'm fine. And took a deep breath. I kind of sat down. I called my parents. I called Michael, he was my husband then. I called my husband. I called my best friend. And that was kind of how it all played out, like, very quickly. And then I got to the rink about 4 hours later. And I really wish I could have got my skate sharp. And that's the one thing that didn't happen because I didn't want to, like, ask. I probably could have asked, but I was like, this is just craziness, because once it became public, obviously, like, I was going to the rink, I was doing interviews, and I'm like, I kind of got to get dressed here, like, and then I got dressed, and finally, I'm like, can I go on the ice for warm-ups, because we weren't going to go on the ice as demonstrators, but I'm like, can I just kind of get my legs moving a little bit, and no one knew the answer, so they're calling Patrick, like, can she go on the ice, they're like, let her on the freaking ice, now, like, let her out. I'm like, okay, phew. So I get on the ice, and I'm like, so nervous, like, I felt so nervous, just, I don't know why, but that was like, I was more nervous then, and Henrik Lundqvist was in net, and I've said this story before, but I was like, I don't even need to shoot a puck. I'm skating in a circle. Like, I'm not doing anything with pucks today, but I just want to shoot on Henrik Lundqvist. Like, that's pretty cool. So I obviously just like flipped a puck into him, and then just kind of skated a few laps, and then I got off the ice, and I was in the Pacific locker room, and I'm sitting there, I think it was the Pacific locker room. And I'm just kind of sitting there, like, looking around, like, don't really have any friends, you know, kind of like, well, am I in the right place? And I remember Marc-Andre Fleury came up to me, and, you know, he introduced himself, and I was like, I know who you are, nice to meet you, and he's like, you're going to do great, and Patrick Kane was there, and he kind of kept talking to him, because I knew him just, you know, from Chicago, and he's like, you got this, you'll be fine, and so, like, some of the players I did know were giving, you know, kind of like, you got this, and then all of a sudden, Patrick comes in and goes, Kendall, you can't be in this locker room. I'm like, well, take me to where I'm supposed to be, because I was brought here. And so they brought me back to the other locker room. And so as you can see, it was like kind of chaotic beforehand. And so then they're like, okay, by the way, you're going first. I'm like, wonderful. Any other surprises that I should be prepared for? But the one thing that really did make me nervous, other than like the warm-ups, was when I was in the men's locker room, and then I had to walk back to our room. I had to walk like almost all the way around the concourse, and I didn't have skate guards on, and there was like, you know, sand and dirt, popcorn, like you step on something, you kind of lose an edge, and like this isn't the moment to lose an edge when you have to like skate like a fastest skater lap in front of like the whole world. So I'm like, okay, like I'm just like looking down, like hope I don't step on anything. But I get back to our room, I was up, you know, fast forward, they cut the ice, I go up first, I get out there, they're like, there's the red line.
Would you like to see it? Oh, sorry, that's not it. That's the 2022 games. We'll get there. This should be it.
So Kendall Coyne up first, an Illinois native out of Northeastern University. She scored two goals for the United States in Pyeongchang last February. Kendall Coyne in the home stretch. 14.346.
She beat her time yesterday. She was here practicing, talked to her before the events got started. She was a little nervous about it, and who wouldn't be? But an outstanding job by Kendall Coyne. Watch the feet move there. The angles are terrific. The edge work is outstanding, and the stride is just amazing. You can watch the miles per hour up top there at 22 miles. An hour was the peak. Some great stuff there, and having some fun with the guys as well.
Down to Pierre.
Thanks a lot, Kenny. What was that moment like?
Oh, it was electrifying. The USA chance. Pretty tired, but awesome to be here.
What was the key to going around the corner so quickly, Kendall?
Just keep my feet moving, cross over, not fall.
So you're skating by all these players. You know what they were doing? Oh my gosh, is she fast. Nobody wants to lose you. Way to go, Kendall.
Thanks, Pierre.
Yes, perfect. And that's 14 seconds, but has a significant impact beyond those 14 seconds. Why do you think this moment matters?
Well, I will say, Keith Jonesy, he was wrong. My time at the rehearsal was actually faster. So that's why I knew when I found out I was doing it, I was like, oh, Berkey, like, what was my time to Patrick? I was like, what was my time in the rehearsal? Because now it actually kind of mattered. And so then when I saw that, I looked up and I was like so disappointed because I'm like, oh, it was slower than the rehearsal one where I just got off the plane. So I'm like, oh no, I wonder what I'm in for, like in terms of what was to come next. And Miro Haskinen from the Dallas Stars went right after me. And he fell. Thankfully, he was okay. There's bumpers on the walls. But I'm like, oh, all right, I beat one guy. I got this. We're good. But then they let him go again. I'm like, no, no, don't let him go again. He fell. Like, you're DQ'd. Now, if you notice, the guys, if they do fall, they do DQ him right away. So I was, like, really excited because I'm like, yes, I beat one. But I did beat another one. But what does that moment mean? I mean, I couldn't tell you what it was going to mean, you know, before it happened, because it happened so quickly. I found out so quickly. But I think it was an incredible moment that opened the eyes of so many people of, wow, like, she can skate, he can skate, they can skate. It doesn't matter. You know, how can I go watch her play? Where can I watch him play? And it helped boost the awareness of the game. Right after that, we played in the first ever rivalry series that I mentioned that we kind of fought pretty hard for. And the ticket sales went up. People were talking about women's hockey. People wanted to talk about that moment. People were asking, you know, okay, so where do you play professionally? Oh, well, let's get into that conversation too. That's another fight that we need to have and another landscape that we need to change in this game. And so the awareness, skating alongside the NHL All-Stars, the best in the game, having the best women, the best men, the best in the game, do what they do on a regular basis together, I think it opened the eyes of so many people of, like, she's a great hockey player. He's a great hockey player. That's the conversation that we want to have. But we need that platform, not just every 4 years at the Olympic Games, not just alongside the NHL All-Stars best. We need that platform on a consistent and regular basis in order for this game to grow the way that it deserves to grow. And so I think that moment really also kind of catapulted that conversation of, wait, we want to watch them more than just 14 seconds skating a fastest skater lap. How do we do that? And then people go to look and they're like, I can't find women's hockey anywhere. Okay, well, media, let's change that. How do we change that? And so I think it really helped that conversation. And I will say, I heard from a lot of people, I never saw anyone with a ponytail play hockey before. And that was actually a big topic of conversation I learned afterwards. USA Hockey wanted me to wear a helmet. And the NHL was like, she's not wearing a helmet. And I advise everyone should wear a helmet. But in this setting, no one was wearing a helmet. So they're like, you're going to make the women wear a helmet and the men aren't going to wear a helmet? Like, what is that saying to society? She's not wearing a helmet, or your men are wearing a helmet. Pick. It's one or the other. And so obviously I didn't wear a helmet, but the fact that people saw my face, they didn't see my face very often, and especially when we wear cages in women's hockey, which I'm quite all right about. I had braces. I like my teeth. I'm okay with cages. But people don't often see, and I'm sure you can touch on this a lot, they do say that's one of the things that hurts women's hockey is the fact that we are so geared up. But I, you know, my argument to that is it's not how we look, it's how we play. And so I hate when people say, oh, well, I can't see your face. Well, I don't care. You can see how I can shoot. You can see how I can skate. It goes back to, you know, I think so often in tennis, right? I can let you talk to this, but, you hear about how pretty the woman is, or how beautiful her swing is. Not how powerful her swing is, it's how beautiful her swing is. No, it's freaking powerful. And so I think, you know, I know that moment with me having my helmet off also did help a lot, because a lot of people were like, whoa, we've never seen a woman really skate like that before. So, yeah.
And if we want to see Kendall skate more, we now have some options. It should be the next one. Your media career too. You have been between the glass as well as a color analyst. So we hear your voice. Is that something you would continue to do more of?
I don't have a lot of time, but I will say anyone in here who's aspiring to have a role in broadcasting, for me, I loved it because I got to talk about sports all day. I got to study players. I got to study the game. I got to study forechecks. I still do that, but when you're preparing for a broadcast, like, you're reading these stories of these players, it's so, like, I loved it. I had so much fun with it. I will say, when that red light goes on, like, I got this pit in my stomach that I was like, Eddie Olczyk, I think you heard in the video, I asked, I'm like, does it ever go away? Yeah, it goes away. I'm like, when? Like, because I get, still pretty nervous, and it did go away. It didn't completely go away, but it lightened up as I did. I got more and more reps, but I will say, with broadcasting, the one thing I've learned, the best way to get better at it is to do it. You need reps. It doesn't matter if it's, on NHL, college, juniors, if it is hockey, whatever that sport is, just reps, experience. See what it's like behind the camera. See if you can, any role that you can see yourself doing, even if it's for a day, it's going to make you a better broadcaster, because you kind of understand the total landscape of what's going on to put on a broadcast. I would love it if I could.
But let's talk about the current career, why you don't have any time as a broadcaster.
Yeah, so this has been a very, very long time coming. I'm very excited. I see some young hockey players up here in the front row. I'm sure you guys saw the big news that the Professional Women's Hockey League launched this summer with its inaugural season. And what's so special about this is really the first time that we've had a sustainable and viable professional women's hockey league. I was on the ice today with one of my teammates, Jessie Confer. She's from Northbrook. She got drafted to Toronto. On Saturday, she's packing up her car and she's driving to Toronto to move her life to the team that drafted her. We've never had that women's hockey. It's always been built on convenience. It's been built on where you have your full-time job, maybe where your partner lives, maybe where, you know, your family has a extra home or whatever the case is. It's never been because that's the team that wants you to help win them a championship. And you're being compensated and treated as a professional, so you have the opportunity to go do that and for that to be your job. So I signed with Minnesota as a free agent. There was this is just a year one thing. There was a 3-player free agency per team prior to the draft, just for year one. I was lucky Minnesota wanted me. I was a little nervous, I'm not gonna lie. I didn't know if anyone would really want me at that point because I just had a baby, like 2.5 months up until this point. So I'm like, you know, I don't know if they're going to question if I'm going to ever be the player that I once was. And I think that's the beauty of this league is no one questioned it. And they offered me, so I signed a 3-year deal in Minnesota. And so we're moving up there to open up the season in the new year. January 1 is when the season starts. So we'll have about a year one, 2-month training camp just to get things going. And then years two through the CBA that we signed. And I will say we're the first league to have a CBA before the league starts in sports history. So we bargained.
Collective bargaining agreement.
Yes.
Those of you who don't know the acronym.
We bargained very, very hard. So we signed an 8-year deal. So this, the next year, you know, in 8 years, we'll get back to the table and pound the pavement, boots on the ground, and work hard to make the league what it is today better for, you know, tomorrow. And I already have things on my list, if you're wondering, because that's how you got to operate. What's next? But we're very, very, very excited. This has been a long time coming. We finally have the investment behind the game that has been so overdue that's going to allow this league to be successful. It's going to allow these players to be professional. It's going to allow the game to be visible and to grow and to be marketed the way that it deserves to be and should be if it is truly professional.
I want to give you a chance if you have a question that you'd want to ask. There are a couple of microphones set up. I'll ask you both, Kendall and Dr. Angelini, if you think we're at a good place and optimism is due for where women are in sport.
I mean, without a doubt. I mean, we're seeing more opportunities than ever before. I mean, the Professional Hockey League is prime amongst them. We're seeing more and more coverage. We're seeing more and more positive coverage. Are we where we need to be? Not quite yet. We still have a road to go, but we're better than we were, you know, 5, 10, 20 years ago. I think optimism, and you have to stay optimistic. I mean, if you're not optimistic, I mean, you got to be happy to move forward and keep moving forward. You got to keep that momentum going. So I think optimism is most definitely the way to go, and I think it's appropriate at this time.
And I think in the span of my career, and it's been very short, it feels like it's been very long, but I look back, it's just a very short part of my life, and I look at the change that's been made in this very short period of time. It makes me look around the room and say, what else can we change? What else can we make better? What other opportunities can we grow? And it's just, it's thinking, it's pushing, it's never settling. It's looking and realizing, you know, this situation is wrong, or how do we make this more equal? I think we all can look through, whether it's sport or society, look through that lens, and it's hard. It's every day it's hard, but I'm very optimistic where things are at right now, and I'm going to continue to remain optimistic because that's what keeps me going. There's days that you sit back and you feel like you got punched in the mouth, but it's like those punches that you continuously take for the ones, that rise you above those days.
Like I said, I want to give you a chance. If you have any questions, there's a couple of microphones. A small plug for you. We've got out in the lobby for a little bit of a reception afterwards. If you'll join us for pucks and sticks or brownies and biscotti. There's a reception out in the lobby. We have Kendall's book out there, Cash Check or Venmo. I can't recommend it enough. It really is a fun, engaging, you get a sense of her journey, and it's very, very inspirational. And so Kendall will be out there for a little while as well. And so if you want to see that gold medal, we'll bring those gold medals and that gold and silver medals out there. Will you thank my guests with me for joining us this evening? Thank you all. We will meet you out in the lobby then.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.